This time on episode 167 of Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., we're going to go through a spoiler-free first thoughts on Iron Fist, the newest Netflix Marvel series. We're going to talk about Luke Cage episode Manifest. We're going to talk about the weekly Marvel news and your feedback. I'm Stargate Pioneer from the official GunnaGeek.com podcast, a proud member of the Gunna Geek Network, just like the one you're listening to now. The opinions expressed are those of each individual. Check out all the other podcasts at GunnaGeekNetwork.com and get ready because geekiness begins in 3, 2, 1.
You have been granted clearance by Director Jeffrey Mace. Stand by for S.H.I.E.L.D. debriefing. All information to be discussed here is classified and may only be discussed among agents granted clearance by the S.H.I.E.L.D. director.
Now it's time for your scheduled debriefing. I'm Director Stargate Pioneer.
I'm Agent Thorne.
Welcome to Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., a Marvel Comic Universe fan show. This show is recorded on Wednesday, March 22nd, 2017. Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. is a fan-based podcast on the ABC television show Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Marvel's Daredevil Jessica Jones, and Luke Cage on Netflix. And now, with more Iron Fist, the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and the Marvel Comic Universe in general.
Because we're getting really tired of always having to buy new clothes.
If you'd like to talk to us about clothes shopping, which I am indeed tired about, you can find us on our website, legendsofshield.com.
You can get a hold of us at our voicemail, 844-THE-BUS-1. That's 844-843-2871.
The ladies of the podcast run a Facebook page. That's at Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. on Facebook.
We have a Twitter account, which you can find at Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D.
And also, our video companions can be found at YouTube. That's youtube.com/GunnaGeek.
And remember, Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. is a proud member of the GunnaGeek.com network.
What we're going to do today, since Haley cannot be with us, she got a little tied up at work, so we're going to go press ahead. Lauren's going to give her first thoughts on Iron Fist today. Haley's going to come back next week. She's going to give her first thoughts on it. And then we're going to go into the Luke Cage episodes both this week and next week. So stay tuned for all that goodness. First of all, I have not seen a lick of Iron Fist. I've just heard an awful lot about it. But I want to hear from our resident agent who has seen the Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. or the Iron Fist show. And Lauren, what do you got to say?
Okay, so I will say that I went in with rock bottom expectations. You might remember us talking about how, well, the reviews aren't so great.
That's right. Lots of stuff before it came out. I believe we said it had like an 18% on Rotten Tomatoes going into the series.
So I will say that it's not terrible. It definitely could have been better. The female characters on the show are all fantastic, in my opinion. The moral of the show seems to be women are greatly inconvenienced by men. And Danny Rand is definitely the weakest of all the Marvel protagonists. Like, I kind of get what they were going for with him, but I don't think it really plays out that well cinematically. You know, we've talked ad nauseum about the casting controversy, about just a lot of stuff involving the series. I will say that the writing doesn't seem to be the strongest. The world building, like, there's a lot of stuff that just kind of seems patched over. But again, a lot of the female characters are fantastic, and it sort of made up for it. David Wenham's character, really interesting. Colleen Wing and Claire Temple were in almost every episode, and they are wonderful. So if you're going to watch it for them and pretend it's a show about them. It's definitely, if you were, you know, counting all the first seasons of each show as its own thing, this is definitely the weakest of the first seasons of each one.
Hmm. Yeah, I was thinking about this whole thing again. We talked about it last week. We're like, what is your favorite series? Of course, I have not seen Iron Fist yet, but I said Luke Cage might be the funnest, although there was Daredevil season one. So I think I have to put Daredevil season one on top of it all, which is good because that's what started it off. And we're really looking forward to the Defenders. But Luke Cage is almost neck and neck with it. And I'm really curious as to where Iron Fist fits for me. Now, Lauren, did you have a different ranking for maybe Jessica Jones in there somewhere?
Actually, I've been thinking about it a lot this past weekend. And I would also have to say that Luke Cage is probably at the top of my list.
Hmm.
Daredevil season one and Jessica Jones are vying pretty hard for second place. Daredevil season one, I feel like it was just such an incredible start and it was just so solid. But Jessica Jones, I mean, personal reasons, I love it. And I thought that the writing on it was really tight.
Now, in relation to other TV series out there, and you can go outside of Netflix and the online on-demand stuff like with Amazon Prime, stuff like that, where would you rank Iron Fist among them? And I don't know, maybe you want to confine it to comic book shows, so like the CW shows and whatever. Where would Iron Fist be better than, say, Arrow?
I'd confine it to other shows that are similarly martial arts based. So you have shows like Into the Badlands and yes, Arrow. And I mean, even Buffy to some extent. The martial arts in Iron Fist is better than Buffy. It is not as good as Into the Badlands. The fighting style is much different than Arrow. But I think it really would have benefited from having somebody who was actually trained in martial arts as the lead character. I mean, Finn Jones, bless him, he tries, but there's a YouTube series that I really like. It's called Every Frame a Picture, and they go through and they talk about all these different aspects of filmmaking. And there's one about, the career of Jackie Chan. And one of the things that's kind of emphasized is that the reason why Jackie Chan's, especially Hong Kong movies, are so popular is because there are so many long takes where you can see the choreography. It's not like, you know, you watch a lot of particularly American movies and there's just so many fast cuts, because if a take doesn't go well, you're going to have to just intersperse it. It's not like, you know, in Drunken Master or something where you have this long take and if one thing doesn't go right, you have to reset it and restart all over again. And I'm a fan of the longer cuts because it shows the artistry of the choreography of the scene. Iron Fist is a victim of too many fast cuts. You don't get the impression, really, that this is somebody who knows martial arts. You get a lot of the impression that this is stunt doubles, which is, again, I've been watching a lot of Xena Warrior Princess lately.
Oh.
One of the things that I love pointing out when I'm watching it is stunt double. I love pointing out stunt doubles. Anytime you can't see somebody's face, it's very likely a stunt double. And there's a lot of stunt doubling going on in this show.
Right. I just heard that Michael Bay's just starting to shoot or just ending to shoot or whatever the next Transformers movie. And I was thinking, that's one of the things that I hate. It is too fast a cut, so you don't see any of the action in that. This is one of the reasons I won't see it again in the theater until Michael Bay removes himself from the Transformers series. I don't like it, but a lot of people do like it because it's huge in China, right? And they make billions of dollars because of it, so good on them. But in this case, the action probably would have been better with somebody that knew martial. I think we're at that stage now where real effects have to be in there. I know we could do a lot with special effects, but on a TV show budget, you need to have actual effects. Now, let me ask you this. How did you watch the series? There was, what, 13 episodes? Did you catch them all on Friday? Did you string them out throughout the weekend? How'd you do that?
Let's see. I watched like 5 or 6 on Friday. I watched a couple on Saturday, and then I just binged on Sunday. I finished right before midnight on Sunday. I watch a lot of TV while I get my day job work done.
So I heard the first few episodes were slow. Is the entire series methodical like that, or is it just really the big setup at the beginning?
It picks up towards the end. But yes, the setup at the beginning is very slow. Another thing that I feel like the series really suffers from is the lack of a central villain. Because, okay, season one of Daredevil, you have Kingpin. Season one of Jessica Jones, you have Kilgrave. Season one of Luke Cage, I mean, at the very beginning, you have Cottonmouth. We'll talk more about that later. But you always have, at least in the first 6 episodes, which are what they send to, you know, to critics and everything, there's always a strong central villain. Here, Danny's just kind of pitted against this vague thing of the hand. And you have a problem where, and again, I feel like I know what the writers were trying to do, which is the hand is this vague, nebulous thing and it's everywhere and nowhere. But I feel like it didn't quite work.
Are we talking about the left hand or the right hand? What are we talking about? Is it a robot hand?
Funny you should say that. You'll see when we watch the show.
I can't wait. Once again, I am not anti-Iron Fist here. I just haven't seen Iron Fist all the way through, and we're taking it one episode at a time because when it came out, I didn't have time to watch it all the way through, which has now snowballed because I have not seen all of Luke Cage, and I want to see it before I see Iron Fist. So as soon as I get done watching Luke Cage, I might start sprinkling in a few Iron Fist episodes as I can. But we will be covering Iron Fist as we get done with Luke Cage this summer, and we will continue our coverage of the Marvel Netflix universe in the summer. Any last hits on your first impressions on Iron Fist before we move on to Luke Cage?
Okay, a couple things. It is not the worst TV show ever. I've seen way worse. I did see one description that I really liked of Danny Rand is like that hippie college student, the rich hippie college student who goes away for a semester to China and comes back spouting pseudo-Buddhist nonsense. And it really does feel like that. And also, I can completely see why Asian Americans are upset with this show. So, just again, all of that.
Okay, all fair. And to your first point, I do have college age kids, and yeah, you do get some of that coming home and spouting nonsense out of their mouth where you're wondering, where did they pick this stuff up? And it's the same sort of stuff, by the way, that I picked up, you know, 30 years ago when I was in college, and I must have come home and my parents were like, wait, this is not the same person that left our home. And yeah, that's true. And it happens to every generation, although maybe not to the extent as Danny Rand, but I'll have to wait and find out.
But yeah, Colleen and Claire are fantastic. Claire continues to be the only one in any of these series with any lick of common sense. And she's amazing. And there is a moment in the finale that made me actually scream in happiness involving Claire. So it is not a complete and total waste of time, in my opinion.
Was it a science baby scream, or was it a Luke Cage scream, or how'd it go?
Claire scream of happiness.
Claire! Right? Did I get that right?
Claire!
Okay, fair enough. All right, folks, we'll get Haley's first impressions next week, and then we will continue on with our Luke Cage watch, and then we will take each episode one by one of Iron Fist later this summer. We're going to get on to some great Luke Cage. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're talking about the seventh episode of Luke Cage, pretty much the first episode in the second act. I can tell as I'm watching it, I think the last episode closed it off, the first six episodes. This one is titled Manifest. It was directed by Andy Goddard, who has 28 credits to his name going back to 1998. Of note in his directing repertoire is six episodes of Torchwood, which unfortunately Haley's not here, otherwise she would gush over him. One episode of Doctor Who, one episode of Once Upon a Time, which is growing in popularity in my household, one episode of Daredevil, one episode of Luke Cage, one episode of Iron Fist, and one episode of The Punisher, which I've heard is still shooting right now. So looking forward to seeing how that series turns out. No Defender directing credit on Andy's list yet, we'll put it that way. Lauren, what do you got for the writer of the episode?
For the writer, I'm showing Akela Cooper, who has six writing credits to her name. The first one, Tron Uprising.
Woohoo!
Yay! She also has story editor for 19 episodes of Grimm and written by three episodes. One episode of Witches of East End. Executive story editor for 16 episodes of The 100.
No. It's not The 100. It's 100. Gotta say it like that. The 100.
Two episodes of Luke Cage, this one Manifest, and Soliloquy of Chaos, which we will be covering eventually. And one episode of American Horror Story. So.
Also the producer of Witches of East End, The 100. Luke Cage and American Horror Story. So a lot of great talent went into this episode, which on face value for the first episode of the second act is kind of methodical plotting, but there's a lot of movement that takes place. We're going to start with some of the flashbacks. A wonderful item that was brought forward in the Arrow television series. And I know it was used in other television series before Arrow, but Arrow is the first one in the comic book genre that's really brought it to the forefront. And we get it in this episode of Luke Cage with basically the backstory. And this time it's with Cottonmouth and Mariah. So Lauren, why don't you run down a little bit about what happened in the past in Mama Mabel's house?
Okay. Well, first of all, is it just me or whenever you have just suddenly background information about a character, you know something big's about to happen with them? Like, we get background information about Scarf and he dies.
That's right. Yeah, we talked about this last time. You're like, you humanize the character and then boom, he's gone. I almost liked Scarf last week before he left. This, on the other hand, there is a lot of really strange, bad crap. This reminded me of some of the bad families in Justified. And Lauren, did you watch the FX series Justified at all?
On my instant watch list, and I haven't gotten around to watching it yet, but I really, really need to.
It's a fun series to watch. It's not the high action impact stuff. A lot of great verbal dialogue back and forth and just some crazy action going on. It's a hillbilly mafia is what it is. And it is fun. It's fun to watch. And you got a gunslinger trying to corral the whole thing along the way. It kind of reminds me of some of the bad families in Justified with the Mabel family. And what was their last name again? Can't remember. Do you remember the last name off the top of your head? I know I've got it written down somewhere. Hold on. I'll find it.
Stokes
family, because Shades does this whole thing about the Stokes family being feared in the future. He's talking to Mariah about it and really setting her up. We'll talk about that in a second. But there's stuff going on in this family. There's stuff with Mariah. There's stuff with Juicy Pops. Pops was in there. And there's stuff with Cottonmouth and then Uncle Pete. And oh, man, just the whole background of how things ran in Harlem 20 years ago and why they are the way they are today. It was messed up. So Lauren, what is your take on the whole family?
We've been hearing a lot about Mama Mabel and kind of what this big mythical figure she was and how, you know, she set up Harlem's paradise and she was this big, kind of a community figure back in the day. And then we actually see her this episode and she's terrifying. You know, we see Cornell in the past before he's really Cottonmouth, and he's a musical prodigy, and he's this young kid, and he just wants to play music, and his family's pushing him in this complete other direction. And we see Mariah, and she's also this young kid, and she's smart, and they're pushing her to her studies. But then at the same time, you know, they're in this environment where, you know, because of Mabel's ruthlessness and everything, they see stuff like, oh, guy's selling heroin in their backyard. So he gets a finger cut off with pruning shears.
Yeah.
And Mariah, you know, when they find out that, you know, Uncle Pete, because, you know, Cornell was late for a thing and she was like, well, I was in an audition. Well, an audition doesn't take that long. They went to go talk to the Puerto Ricans, which that was a nice little touch because, the guy they went to talk to, whose last name is Colon, that is presumably the Colon now's, you know, dad, grandpa, something from back in the day. And so we find out that Uncle Pete's been, you know, back dealing, and Cornell has to go kill him. So again, he's being forced into this position, and we find out that these characters who, yes, they're bad guys now, but, you know, they weren't always. They were forced into the situation until it's like literally all they knew.
Yeah, the history. I got a question on the whole hand thing, the finger thing stuff. Say you're the Foley artist. You know, you're doing some voiceover stuff now. So say you're doing Foley artistry or sound effects, basically, for breaking a hand and clipping off of. How would you record those? What would you record the sounds to have it sound like? Would it be like chicken bones? Or, I mean, how would you do it?
Typically, when you're doing breaking bones, it's celery. So I would imagine you get a pair of scissors or something, and you get a piece of celery, and you just cut it.
There you go. Yes,
nice, wet, snapping noise.
We'll have to have an actual visualization of that next week. So, Lauren, you're going to have to get the celery, get the shears out, and go to town and see if it's the same sound as the Foley artist was in this episode, because I don't think they actually broke anybody's hand in the filming of this episode, although I didn't see any disclaimer that no humans were harmed in the filming of this episode.
Remind me the day before so I could actually go out to the store and get some celery, and I'll see what I can do.
All right, we're looking forward to that. So anything more with the flashbacks on the family that you want to bring out before we move on?
Well, we find out more later in the series. It just keeps coming back to family, because we find out that Uncle Pete was molesting Mariah, and there's just this kind of wellspring of bitterness there, because yeah. Cottonmouth was like, they sent you away to go study, so I got stuck with all this stuff, and that's why I am like I am now. And she's like, you know that I got sent away because he was molesting me. And then he starts getting a dig in on her that, oh, you wanted it. By the way, never, ever, ever say that to somebody who's been molested. That is awful. And yes, as we see, she does not take it well, because Mariah snaps and beats him to death.
With a microphone stand, I might add. So podcasting equipment can be used to bludgeon somebody to death.
Well, anything can be used to bludgeon somebody to death if you're determined enough. But yeah, with a microphone. Well, first she hits him over the head with a thing of like wine or champagne or something. Then she pushes him out a window, and then she beats him to death with the microphone.
I'm surprised he survived the fall. And I thought, oh my gosh, where are they going to go from here? Because he's got to be, you know, paralyzed, a leg that's out of commission or something like that for the rest of the series. But no, it doesn't matter. She bludgeons him to death.
Only a second fall. He can easily survive that.
And then she calmly describes to Shades, who has played her to get her to this point, by the way, calmly describes to Shades, oh yeah, the rubber gloves are in the kitchen next to the sink or whatever. And like, oh yeah, that's great. That's exactly where I would put them. Holy crap, the two of them. It's like they're already in that criminal mastermind tunnel, and it's just going to go downhill from there. But well, wow.
She's very clearly in shock. She does a wonderful job, because you know, right before that, she'd been talking about, you know, I'd been the one who, when you were little, taking care of you because your family abandoned you. And then she has this moment of, I killed my relative. I killed the kid that I used to take care of. And she's just in complete shock, going on autopilot. But yeah, Shades is absolutely 100% just like taking advantage of that. But also, if you've ever talked to someone in shock, the best thing you can do is just talk in a very calm voice. And yeah, okay, don't startle them, because then they will really freak out. Yeah, so sense that he's done something like this before.
or at least he's got enough self-preservation not to do anything like that. So you have the death of Cottonmouth, which I think is valid at this point in the series from a writing standpoint, because he should have been done after last episode. There's no way, really, with internal affairs involved, and there's no way he would have gotten out of prison with the news coverage around the event and everything. In regular society, that's how riots happen. That's how riots have happened. And I just don't think in reality it would have gone down that way. So him dying actually as a story plot is probably valid, not necessarily to prevent riots in a fictitious Harlem, but just he should be done. He should be in prison, although it's a great transference of power to Mariah, and she is showing her true ability to be a crime lord in Harlem. And her political career is basically done anyway, so it was all a nice transition episode for her to get her to wherever she's going, because I haven't seen the series, I don't know where it ends, from where she was. So she had the ability, she had the gumption, and as we discussed last week, by the way, I think Haley was kind of leading me along on that discussion, but definitely I can see it now, Mariah was meant to be the person in charge all along. So back to Shades. He goes to Cottonmouth, and Cottonmouth does two things that Shades is like, whoa, dude. First of all, he wants to go to Diamondback and get the Judas bullets. And Shades is like, whoa, 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 you got to prove yourself before we give you the really good stuff. And Cottonmouth's having nothing of that. He wants to deal with Luke Cage. The other thing that he does that really gets Shades going, what, is he used the information about Seagate on Luke Cage right away. And Diamondback wants to use Luke Cage in the future and doesn't want to startle him. Because, I mean, the typical thing that I would do if I was escaped from prison and somebody told me they knew that I was from prison, I'd get away from there and I'd go somewhere where nobody would know me, because I would want to stay out of prison. So those two things lead Shade to manipulate Mariah into taking some action against Cottonmouth. Now, I don't think he knew that Mariah was going to kill Cottonmouth, but something was going to happen to placate Cottonmouth to the point where he wasn't going to be as reactionary, or I don't know what he was actually trying to play, but he played Mariah to get Cottonmouth to the point to make a move so that Cottonmouth would be off the board for the rest of life, I guess, in this case. And that happened. So yeah, a few great things. So you have Cottonmouth dying as part of the storyline. You got Mariah's rise, and you've got Shades playing the whole thing. I think Shades eventually wants to take over. Do you think Shades wants to take over Harlem at this point? And maybe you can't say because you know, but I think Shades wants to rule Harlem.
He absolutely wants more power. And right now he's attaching himself to Mariah because she's sort of his ticket to the top. I think he knows that Mariah doesn't really have, as he sees it, the constitution. Because, yeah, you saw her freak out and he's like, oh, the first kill's always the hardest. And he knew that Cottonmouth didn't really have the constitution either, because you saw when he's there, and like you said, the whole throwing it, you know, the Luke Cage Seagate thing. He put that trump card out there way too early. The smart thing to do would be to let that sit. And he just kept seeing Cottonmouth making mistake after mistake. He's putting himself in this position, in this organization, to be in the right place at the right time. And he is very definitely ingratiating himself with the right people.
Yeah, he's making the right moves, at least for now. And he had nothing. He grew up from nothing, and he went over that whole thing with Stokes. You know, you needed some school supplies to go see Mama Mabel. You need some protection against your father from hitting you. You go to Mama Mabel, and it would never happen again. So Mama Mabel just take care of things, at least from his perspective. But if you cross her, you're going to end up dead, which happened a few times in the series, whether we saw it or not. So that was interesting, seeing the past of the Stokes family.
And for them, from his perspective, that's all gone, because Cottonmouth has become just really selfish. His thing is all about the money. And Mariah, her thing is all about self-aggrandizement. So there is none of this, you know, sort of Harlem for the people thing that Mama Mabel had.
New Harlem Renaissance is what Mariah was trying to tout. And yeah, that's basically gone now.
Yeah, she says, oh, Harlem Renaissance. But when she talks, it's all about glory for her.
Yeah, and it's not going to be political anymore, as we just described. And oh, by the way, talking about glory, somebody's got glory for actually shooting Carl, a.k.a. Luke Cage. We see the Judas bullets in action, piercing Luke's body with Nurse Claire Temple right there, which is good. But I don't know what this is going to be interesting, because she can't get in there with any surgical instruments and take the bullets out. So I'm very interested to see how Luke recovers from this. Again, I have not seen the series. Want to see next week's episode as soon as I can, which is good. We don't have an Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. episode next week, so I can actually see how this all turns out. But Luke Cage just got himself shot, I believe, twice. Not once, but twice, right?
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, so we'll see how this goes. I mean, he's finally got a vulnerability, and it's not drowning him in the river. It's not poisoning him. It's not taking somebody that he cares about, manipulating him, although he did use the Seagate stuff. It was actually getting shot with the Judas bullets. So that amazing to me. I knew it was coming, but just still amazing that it actually happened. I believe if I did not know it was coming, like if I mainlined it, binged it the first weekend, that probably would have been like, oh, dang. But I still would have seen it coming, because they talked about it before, about two or three episodes ago. All right, Misty. Detective Misty Knight meets an old, we'll call it acquaintance, boss, really, with Inspector Priscilla Ridley. So what can you tell me about the interaction between Misty and the inspector, Lord?
I'm trying to remember right now. Again, we've talked a bit last week about how Misty's sort of under a microscope at the moment, because not one, but two people that she's worked with have both ended up being dirty cops. And her current boss at the department is also saying, like, oh, I'm sort of out of the picture right now, too, because I'm guilty by association. And we're seeing this with Misty as well.
Yeah, I forgot. I don't know why, probably because I watched the first episode so long ago, that Luke Cage started out, and it wasn't the first episode, by the way, it was one of the prison episodes, that he was probably a cop along the way. I don't know how he ended up in prison, but it was something like that. And we found that out, like, as he was getting into the fight rings. And he's talking to Misty, like, he knows what she's going through, and she has nothing to correlate to him, to believe him. And he's trying to commiserate, and she just can't take that on blindness. She needs to offense to Daredevil right there, but she needs to know the truth before actually confiding in Luke. And it's just the trust from her to him is not there. Now Luke trusts her because he sees her as knowing what she's doing now and not one of the dirty cops. Her partner was a dirty cop. She's commiserating with him, or he's commiserating with her and trying to guide her through that. So we'll see what that happens. He does give her the guns, though, which he was just trying to take off the streets. And she was just the cop that he knew to give them to. So she got credit for that. But there is all sorts of stuff that could still possibly happen. I think that Inspector just has it in for her, and it's going to be interesting to see how that relationship works out.
Yeah, Misty's having a really rough time of it lately.
She is. And yeah, we'll just see how that goes, if it gets any better. I suspect because of the numbers of episodes that we have left, things are going to take a turn for her. Maybe two or three turns, maybe four turns. But eventually, I get the feeling that they're going to come out. She's going to come out on top. So we'll just take it from there. All right. Claire, she was there when Luke got shot, but she was also there to urge him on instead just to leave. Like, stay here, take care of things, because Luke is not from Harlem. He has no connection to the area. He's always wanted nothing to do it but do what's right and move on with his life. And when things get hard, he's going to run. Like, I don't need to be here. But Claire's like, look, if you don't do it, nobody else will. And she talks to him the way that only Claire can. And it's great seeing her in this series. I'm glad that she's the centerpiece of Marvel on Netflix right now. I really enjoy every time she's on screen. She hasn't ever had a bad scene. Not one. Her character's awesome.
Yes, I love her. And I can't wait to see what they do with her in Defenders.
It's true. And you've seen her in Iron Fist. I have not yet. I'm looking forward to that. The shooter. Now, I can't remember back to the prison episodes, but it's got to be somebody from the shooter. He knew he was Carl. Could have been somebody from his childhood. I don't know. But I suspect it's somebody from Seagate. So we'll find out more about who that is. What's that?
Nothing.
Okay. So we've got that. All right. We talk about the episode title, Manifest. Lauren, tell me what Manifest is.
Okay, so again, Gangstar lyrics. I'm linking them in the show notes. And I was looking for lines from the lyrics that I'm like, oh, this really does this. And honestly, of all the Gangstar songs so far, this is the one that I feel like maybe does it the least. But anyway, at the end, the make mincemeat of other fools, because I'm the brother who'll snatch up the funds and make lonely ones. I meant it really, because I'm clearly obsessed. And these are the words that I manifest. I think that, like, this whole, you read it, and this is sort of all about Cottonmouth.
Could be about Mariah, too. Like, her manifest on how she's going to handle things in the future.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then Luke Cage going through his manifest of why he's there. And true. Misty, as well, going through her manifest destiny, basically, of what she needs to do to stay in there in the future. So, a lot of great things. And you could say Claire is making a decision to stay in Harlem right now, too. So that might be it as well. All right.
I go for the glory. I'm taking inventory, counting all the tough luck ducks while I narrate. Relate and equate, dictate and debate. My fate is to be cold making history. I mean, it could be any of them, really. They're right. All sorts.
So, did you like the episode? I did. Did you like it?
I think it's one of my favorites because it is really such a turning point in the show.
It is, and it sets it up well. It like after the end of last episode, it was like, why are we even having the rest of the series? There's nothing to hold it over, but they did the transition well. I still think it's a little bit rough getting Cottonmouth out of jail, but by the end of the episode, that's all taken care of. And I think it was done well enough to make the next set of episodes. I don't know if it's the second half of the series or like the second act, maybe out of three, but it sets it up like, okay, I want to see the next episode. And it's not just the shooting of Luke Cage. It's like, what's going to happen with Mariah? What's going on with Harlem? This is all great stuff. And I believe Netflix did it again. Marvel did it again on Netflix with Luke Cage. Any last words on Manifest?
Just all the stuff, the backstory with Cottonmouth and Mariah, I absolutely love.
Looking forward to the future of this. As I just said, next week we will be looking into the next episode. That's Luke Cage episode 8, Blowing Up the Spot. And after that, I believe we will continue on with our Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. coverage because it's back and that's our primary purpose for this podcast, at least for now, until it gets canceled, at least for now. We're still looking for that season 5 renewal. All right, let's get on with some news. Lauren's put together some news for you this week, as she always does. The first one deals with the Inhumans. It's a new, relatively new section in our news, but we've got one talking about Black Bolt.
Yeah, we got new set footage leaked. Comicbookresources.com, well, CBR.com, has a bunch of the tweets that have the footage up all collected. We get Anson Mount, who is playing Black Bolt, running along the street in Hawaii, in Honolulu, and being arrested, presumably in character. I have not heard anything about Anson Mount actually being arrested. Yeah, what's interesting to me is that in this, he's wearing just like normal people clothes and not the black leather that he was wearing last time.
Well, you know, if you're on the run, you don't want to stand out with black leather, especially if you're filming in Hawaii, because that's got to be hot. I can't imagine the amount of baby powder you have to have on your skin in order to be in one of those outfits in Hawaii. Lauren, have you been to Hawaii? I
have, actually.
Yeah, we were discussing this before with the Diamond Head off of Waikiki Beach before.
Actually, the street they're running on.
That's so awesome. So basically, if you have never been out to Hawaii, nominally, it's a tropical balmy temperature of about 78 to 82. Sometimes they have a heat wave and it gets up to 84, 86. And it depends on where you are in the island, whether you're getting that cool Pacific breeze or you're hidden from it and it heats up a little bit more as well. But basically, 80 humid in leather. It's, if you're shooting for any amount of time, that's got to be kind of sticky in there. So yeah, if I had my choice, I'd be in regular clothes too.
Yeah. I mean, so when we went to Hawaii, I'm leaving from, you know, Texas. Granted, it was Texas in the winter at the time, but still, I live in a part of Texas that can be generally described as a butt crack in terms of humidity and heat. And Hawaii was just so nice. But yeah, in either place, I mean, I would not recommend wearing just black leather constantly because sticky and sweaty and absorbing the sun's rays. So yeah, wear something flowy and loose and preferably try to stay, if you're in Texas, stay indoors, if at all possible. In Hawaii, go outdoors and enjoy the breeze.
So once again, Lauren, Agent Lauren is the butt crack of Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. And we are looking forward to the Inhumans series next year. Moving on into some Netflix series. We just covered a couple of Netflix series in this show so far, but we have some further news. First of all, we've talked a lot about this, but the comic creator of Iron Fist downplays the whitewashing concerns. And I've heard about this, but I want to get your take, Lauren.
Okay, so Roy Thomas, who created the character of Iron Fist back in the 70s, May 1974, was talking about the Netflix show, and in particular, a lot of fans' concerns about the casting and hoping that we would have an Asian or Asian American Iron Fist. And he was downplaying it a lot. I this interview, I mean, yes, he created it, but it's like a thing that was created off of a really, really unfortunate trend at the time, which was the kind of white savior Eastern appropriation thing.
A little bit Tom Cruise Last Samurai action going on back then, right?
Yeah, very, very much so. Yeah. And yeah, his thing was Iron Fist. Okay, if something is really racist or degrading to a sex or race, an ethnic group or something like that, then that's something else. But Iron Fist isn't that and never has been. It's all about a fictitious race, a fictitious place like a Shangri-La, and one person who happens to be its emissary. The problem is that it's really, really based on an actual ethnicity and an actual belief system, and it's an actual place in the world. And this is a problem right now that we're having in Hollywood, where Asian actors are having to go to a whole nother country if they want to get roles beyond nerdy guy in the background or girlfriend who says like two lines. So, I mean, this was an opportunity to maybe have, you know, an Asian American leading man and kind of point out, you know, kind of do away with some of the stuff that was really kind of icky about the original Iron Fist thing. And Marvel didn't do that. Okay. So we get the show, and Marvel has the opportunity to maybe, again, do away with some of the kind of questionable stuff on there, and they didn't do that. And okay, we've talked about this.
Yeah, we have. And I just want to clarify, girlfriend roles on TV movies, you don't have to say anything. You're just there for arm candy. You don't need the two lines, right? Come on.
Oh, clearly not. I mean, who needs a brain anyway?
We're totally kidding and being sarcastic, people. Exactly. We're going to move on to the next one, and it is Jessica Stroup and Tom Pelfrey answer questions on a hashtag Ask Marvel.
Yes, these two play Joy and Ward Meacham in Iron Fist, and they did a little, I guess, 2.5 minute long video for Marvel talking about Iron Fist and their characters, and it's just a fun, cute little thing. Nothing really big or spoilery or anything like that. So yeah, check it out.
So moving on to the next one. This one is very interesting to me. I don't have a big history with the character, not at all, but the comic that was out in the all new, all different Marvel universe intrigued me enough to learn more about the character. And that is Venom. It was Venom Space Knight. Of course, the space title got me, I'll admit it. And I've learned more about the character, maybe not my favorite character in the world, but Sony, just out of the blue, just randomly said, hey, we're going to do a Venom movie!
Yeah. Sony's been talking about this for years. Like, I think this was the plan when they put Venom in Spider-Man 3. And then that, you know, happened. I don't know what to think.
It'll depend on the characteristic of the character and the suit, the Venom suit itself, because it's really two different entities. It's not the same as the cloak and Doctor Strange. It's more more entwined than that. And the suit, the Venom parasite, has, it depends on how they go with it. It's a character on its own, really. A symbiote, basically, if you want to go to Star Trek DS9 or you want to talk about Stargate SG-1 with the Goa'uld, it's that sort of thing. So it really depends on how they take this and how they go. I think Sony is just trying to resurrect anything that they can from the franchise before really just handing it back to Marvel and saying, here, give us our cash, like billions of dollars of cash, because they've announced movies that they have done nothing with. Look at Sinister Six. It's not going to happen anymore because it was not going to be good and they needed Marvel help. So I have my doubts on whether this is actually going to happen.
Yeah, they announce it. We'll see what actually ends up happening.
Yep, definitely. So we're just going to move on to some happier notes. And let's talk a little bit, and we've got a couple of notes here along these lines, Guardians of the Galaxy 2.
Yeah, we got a little bit more casting news. Did you watch Smallville ever?
Yeah, I watched one episode and it was the one with the Green Arrow in it.
Okay. My sister and my cousin were really, really into it. Michael Rosenbaum, who played Lex Luthor in the show, is joining the cast of Guardians of the Galaxy 2. And according to James Gunn, he will be having a pretty decent role in the movie, who sort of works in tandem with Sylvester Stallone's character. We don't know who they're playing yet. And also something that kind of made me nerd out, Terry Notary, who is a really good CGI actor. If you ever watch like the behind the scenes stuff for Lord of the Rings or The Hobbit, he's always on there. He's also in like all the Planet of the Apes movies and stuff like that. Well, he's also going to be in it. So he's going to be playing some CGI character. But yeah, Lex Luthor going to be in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2.
Awesome. Looking forward to that. And then Black Cat and Silver Sable movie? Really?
Yeah, more from Sony trying to cash in on Spider-Man stuff. It's looking like Chris Yost, the guy who wrote and created X-23, he's done a lot of comics. I've met the guy. He's really nice. He also wrote one of my favorite Spider-Man comics, Scarlet Spider, the newer incarnation with the Kane, which I read because it took place here in Houston. But he is working on the latest draft of the script for it. A first draft was written by Lisa Joy, who's one of the creators of Westworld. And we have no idea if it's going to happen, if it's going to connect with the new Spider-Man movie, if it's going to connect with Venom, if it's going to connect with the Marvelverse. We just know that apparently they're working on it. And I mean, it could be a female-led movie. Given the two characters, it could be like a really awesome heist movie, maybe? I don't know.
Oh, heist movie! Yeah, you got me at heist movie. I'll do that. Heist movie. Yay! Heist movie. SP happy. Heist movie. I the whole Italian Job, the whole Oceans thing, is a heist movie. I get on heist movies. They're great. Now, Thomas Crown Affair, Italian Job, yay. Oceans, yay. So, I've heard rumors of the Ocean's 11 reboot with all female characters. I'd be fine with that. It's a heist that I care about. The heist.
Something's 8, something like that.
Yeah, lots of good stuff. Now, moving on to something that is squarely in Lauren's squee territory. It's X-Men. So we have, I thought we reported that they did indeed cast Cable, or did they not cast it and there was just a front runner?
Have not cast Cable yet, but latest news as of today is that Michael Shannon, who you might know as Zod from Man of Steel, the Cable frontrunner. I know him best from Boardwalk Empire. He's also been in a whole bunch of movies. I think he could be a really interesting Cable because he's got this really like deadpan thing going on. But if you ever get a chance, listen to him on The Nerdist. He's really, really funny. But again, it's in this really deadpan way. Like one of my favorite things, he had a really brief cameo in Batman versus Superman as a corpse. Spoiler, I guess. But when people were asking him about, what does, Zod do in the new movie? His thing was, well, this time he has flippers. And he was joking, but because he's so deadpan all the time, people thought he was serious and they really started reporting on that. And I think that really, like, just absolutely just straight-facedness could really be great for Cable. So, I mean, there's a bunch of people that I'd love to see as Cable. I hadn't even thought of him. But yeah, do it. Plus, make him run. Dude has the weirdest run. There's an episode of Boardwalk Empire where he like pushes a guy over and then starts running like a big weirdo. It's great.
I think even the way he talks, like almost with a slight lisp, would really be great for the Capo character. I don't know why, but it just would. I'm really looking forward to that if it does happen, but we'll see. Maybe we'll get something else next week until the final. This is almost like the casting of Doctor Strange, where we're like, is it going to be this? Is it going to be him? Is it going to be him? Are they going to do a gender swap? That went on for like a year and a half. This probably is not going to go on for a year and a half. They've got to shoot the movie pretty soon, but it could go on for a while. So we're still going to report this. Like we stopped reporting the Doctor Strange thing, but it's almost to that point. Almost. Now, unfortunately, Haley's not here because Haley really needs to read this next story to help her understand what the F is going on with Legion. And after watching the latest episode myself, I am completely in that boat as well. I'm pretty sure I'm following what's going on, but at the same time, I could be completely wrong. And this almost is bugging me to the point where it might rage quit the series, but if it turns out the way I think it's going to turn out, they did a marvelous job, and I can't wait to cover it on this podcast after we do Iron Fist. So what we're talking about is the reveal of the big bad on Legion.
So I've only seen the first episode. I still need to catch up. I should do that maybe this week. There's this weird little guy that's been showing up since the first episode. It's this weird little like lump of a guy. And they finally revealed that identity. And dun dun dun, it's Amal Farouk, the Shadow King from the X-Men comics. Which makes a lot of sense. He's this guy that like jumps into people's minds and messes with them. And IO9 has a really interesting article about, here's what you need to know about the Shadow King. So yeah, that actually, I mean, as far as, you know, an X-Men bad guy who's messing with people's minds go, that's a pretty excellent choice.
Mm-hmm. And oh, by the way, in the chat room, we've got a couple of comments about a tail coming out of your head. So I think it's time to introduce the other agent from the butt crack of Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D.
That right there?
Yep.
The Agent the Sack Cat. That is Fatty.
There you go. Agent the Sack Cat. Sack Cat, aka Fatty. So for everybody in the chat room, I think Mike Howard was particularly interested in that, or he was interested in the special effects, actually. But no, it's a real cat. It's not special effects. It's not like Jaws. We don't have an anime. We don't have like Frank Oz or anything floating around controlling that thing. It's a real cat, Fatty. There you go. Right, moving on into the news. We've got one more for you tonight, and that is Spider-Man's eyes are now reality.
Yes, remember, I think it was last week we were talking about Spider-Man's eyes.
Yeah.
Or maybe I was talking to somebody about Spider-Man's eyes and how cool it was that it's like, oh, it's like a camera lens.
Mm-hmm.
So a cosplayer named Lenses Factory HK has spent the past couple months developing a mechanical version of those eyes. And there's a link and a video on IO9 showing how he did it. And it's really cool. And I have never been that involved with cosplay. Like, I always want to be like, oh, I rigged up this thing. And I'm always really cheap and lazy. So,
right.
Good on that guy.
Well, a couple of years ago, we did talk to the 3D printer who was doing cosplay, and he had the whole Deadpool mask and everything. And there's a lot of neat things you can do because of 3D printing now that we couldn't do just a few years ago. So cosplay has been taken to another level, and there's the whole professional level of cosplayer. Like, there's professional cosplayers that get paid to go to events like Jessica Nigiri, I believe that is her name. She's kind of famous for all of her costumes and everything. Beautiful woman, but she's a geek, and she just geeks out on all this stuff and makes her own stuff. Although now I'm wondering if she really does or not, but she's been to some of the same cons. She was at C2E2 last year while I was there. And so it was just nice seeing not only her, but everybody around. Matter of fact, our very own, that one of the original members of Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., Beef, Agent Beef, he cosplayed as Deadpool last year. It was really fun.
Yeah. Oh, skipping back a story, speaking of Legion, somehow it completely slipped my mind that Dan Stevens from Legion is also the Dan Stevens that's in the new Beauty and the Beast.
No.
So, yeah, keep that in mind if you are a Legion fan who goes to see Beauty and the Beast. Same dude, he can sing.
Interesting. I have not seen Beauty and the Beast, but apparently it made a lot of records and a lot of people happy over the weekend, so pretty cool. If we get some numbers on that, well, you know what? I bet you Haley went to see it a bunch of times, so we'll ask her about it next week. In the meantime, it's time to move on. Some feedback. All right. Once again, we are saved by our fans. Thank you very much, by the way, to everybody who tweets us. Even with news stories, we really appreciate it. Really helped out on a night like tonight, where Haley got stuck at work and we weren't able to do the complete prep for the show. But thankfully, throughout the week, we got great tweets from people like at Mr. Paracletes, who we didn't talk about this before because I wanted to give all accolades to Mr. Paracletes. Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3 is confirmed. Yes. And 2 isn't even out in the theater. I am so fired up for this. This is going to be great. More Rocket, more Groot, more of the clan. It's going to be fun.
Yeah, makes me happy. Also, Christy at Adonna Girl retweeted Vanity Fair for St. Patrick's Day. Ruth Nega, who you might remember as
Flowers.
Yes. Raina, the girl with the flower dress. She demonstrated the proper way to make an Irish coffee because she is, in fact, Irish. So I'm going to have to watch this.
If you need to know how to make true Irish coffee, she...
Just, you know, thrown some Baileys in mine. I guess I take it that's not the proper way.
Well, whatever gets the job done, but no, not the proper way indeed. At Mr. Paracletes tweeted us with this news story about the real life Spider-Man mask. So I just wanted to give some accolades to Mr. Paracletes. Thank you very much for linking us with that. And one last tweet.
Christy again at Adonna Girl said, damn, life in the framework agrees with Fitz. EW.com has a thing about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.'s return and Brett Dalton's return. And they have some new set photos and everything. Yeah, Fitz rocking that three-piece suit. Ward also rocking a suit and a green tie because presumably Hydra.
Yeah, so longtime listeners of Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. will go back way before Lauren had joined the cast, and they can listen to about a 6-minute rant that I had on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. about the character Agent Ward. Had nothing to do with Brett Dalton. I am so glad they ended Brett Dalton's arc like they did, and I'm so glad he's back, presumably to close out the series. It's going to be a fun end to this season, at least, and I just can't wait. So thank you for bringing back Brett Dalton in such a great way. I know it's going to be fun to have him on the show. Any last items of feedback you want to run through before we walk this one out?
I don't think we got any Facebook comments this week.
Nope. Well, go ahead. You can contact us on Facebook, and Lauren and Haley will be there to respond to you. And I do know that there are a couple other people that might be able to respond to you on there. Not me. I actually am not on the back end of the Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. Facebook page because, well, Stargate Pioneer doesn't have a Facebook account. Thanks, Facebook. I love you too. All right, let's walk this one out. Next week, we're going to be discussing Luke Cage, Episode 8, Blowing Up the Spot. Haley will also give her first thoughts on Iron Fist. Just a reminder, I've been talking all about this. If anybody has questions about it, please ask me. But Michelle Ely from Starling Tribune and a writer, blogger on Gonna Geek, and myself are going to be at Indiana Comic Con April 14th through 16th. We're going to do not one, not two, but 3 panels, one each day, talking about different aspects of co-hosting as well as Podcast 101 sort of questions. So you're welcome to join us there. Friday, 2 p.m. Saturday, 11:30 a.m. and Sunday at 11 a.m. And in the meantime, you can always find me here with Lauren and Haley Wednesday nights, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific on www.geeks.live as we stream Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. live every week. And you can join the chat room and chat with such notable people like Mike Howard, JPEG to Raw, and Stephen J, just generic Stephen J, no relation to the Stephen that runs the Gonna Geek Network.
Yeah, and I want to thank everybody on Twitter, whether you're following along with live tweets, whether you're live tweeting us yourself, whether you're sending us news. We really, really, really appreciate that last one.
Or as long as it's news and not nudes. I just have to qualify news, N-E-W-S, not nudes, N-U-D-S, especially generic Stephen J. Do not want to see that.
Not officially condone people sending us nudes. But yes, we really, really appreciate it. We love hearing from you. And we love knowing that you're thinking of us because we think of you all the time.
And hey, Lauren really thinks of you all the time when she's live tweeting, which next week will be Monday night because it's a Netflix series that's already been out. But when Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. comes back on, it will be Tuesday night, 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central. And you can catch her at Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. during those times for the live tweets. You still get a lot of likes and people interacting with you and everything. It's a really fun time, isn't it?
It really is. And next week on Monday, I have to check my calendar because I don't remember dates anymore.
It'll be
Monday, March 27th at 8 p.m. Central, 9 p.m. Eastern. I will be live tweeting Luke Cage, episode 8, Blowing Up the Spot.
Looking forward to that.
More misty, more fun.
There you go. Well, that's it for this week. Thank you for joining us tonight. It was really great. And Haley will be joining us again next week. It was just late breaking that she couldn't be with us here tonight. We miss her. Until next time, I'm Director Stargate Pioneer. See you guys next week. Bye.
Thank you for listening. If you want to leave us feedback, go to gunnageek.com and you will find all our contact information and other shows. You can also visit legendsofshield.com where you'll find our complete archive of podcasts. The music heard on this podcast is by Kevin McLeod, found at incompetech.com and also artists on pond5.com and audiojungle.net. The opinions heard on this podcast are those of the individual hosts and do not represent Stargate Pioneer Productions, Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D., or Gunna Geek. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is the property of the Disney Corporation, Marvel Studios, and ABC. No infringement is intended. Legends of S.H.I.E.L.D. is copyright 2017.